pain is in the building.
Trying to fuck with Hollywood Cole. I'm with Marley G, bro. Flying Hollygrove chicks to my Hollywood shows. And I want to tell you something that you probably should know.
All right, and welcome into another episode of the Buffalo Basement Podcast. I am your host, Matt Deggert. I have my co-host, as always, to my right, Pat Bruckness. And as you see down below, we have a very, very special guest tonight, Big O, Jerry Ostroski, formerly of the offensive line of the Buffalo Bills. And I'll let him introduce his podcast as well. And we'll go from there. Welcome in, Jerry.
Hey, I appreciate you guys having me on. Thanks for thinking of me and shooting the invite out. But yeah, we go on 9 o'clock Eastern, 8 o'clock Central on the Buffalo Rumblings Vidcast Network. We're on every week, and show is called Line to Gain. It's myself and Sarah Larson, and we do part of our show. We talk about the Buffalo Bills, and then usually about the last 15 minutes or so, we talk about college football, latest trends in football. Obviously, lots and lots of Deion Sanders talk that's going on right now. Do some college game pick'ems and everything. But yeah, on there every week on Wednesday. Also do a Monday podcast. It's Rumblings Preview. I preview the Monday night game every week. I tell on myself. I actually did pick the Jets to win this week. Did not think it was going to go the way that it went, but I did pick the Jets to win this week. It was just, to me, it was just a tough game for the Bills. Seemed like a trap game, almost like that Bengals game last year when they went down to Cincinnati. Of course, the terrible circumstances with DeMar Hamlin. And so those are the two things I'm doing right now on Rumblings. And I like to get on with, guys that, have other podcasts. And if they want me to come on, I'll talk to them as well. So I appreciate you having me on, guys.
Absolutely. Anytime, Jerry. And, it was almost like a first game of the year trap game. And it's not one of those where you're like overlooking, but it's almost like as soon as Aaron Rodgers went down, it was like, uh-oh, we're in trouble, because you're game planning for Aaron Rodgers and everything else going on. And Zach Wilson comes in and, he did only lead one touchdown drive, but they did put up, 16 points with short fields and everything like that. So I like to put those games out of the back of my mind, but we will get into it a little bit here. See the old football part of me, and I'm sure you're kind of the same way. Got to have the short memory. But with that being said, I do want to let everybody know we are sponsored by and brought to you by Sons of Erie. Definitely check them out, www.sonsoferie.com, for any of your art needs. Check out their art, and I know I'm going to be ordering a couple pieces off of there here very shortly. So definitely want to thank them for sponsoring us here tonight. And what do you think? Like, how do you think that game went, Jerry? more in depth than just they lost.
Well, I guess before we get into the game itself, I kind of want to talk a little bit about the culture right now in the NFL and what I think is going on. And it revolves around the preseason and offseason stuff. And in recent collective bargaining agreements, there's some things that have been agreed upon. And over the years, the trend has been to try to keep players away from facilities a little bit more. Players wanting more freedom in the offseason felt like they were having to do too much. So some of the new rules, they limited OTA workouts, obviously added the 17th game, which in turn then took away a preseason game. And there's been this trend of, while players might be meeting, while players might be practicing, it seems to me anyway that coaches have kind of tried to keep, especially key players, fresh. And what I mean by that, maybe not really play a lot of preseason, not really do too much hitting, maybe not do a lot of tackling in practice. And I think if you saw week one, yes, we're excited that the season has started, right, guys? I mean, we got football going on. It's on tonight. Vikings and Eagles, but I think it set us up for probably the worst week of NFL football, especially opening week football, that I think I might have seen. The football on Sunday was terrible. I didn't think it was very good at all. There's a few games that were okay. There were some teams that performed well, but all in all, the football was not very good. And I think it's because we're resting players. And I personally think that guys need a preseason. They need to go ahead and get reps in. They need to play. And here's the reason why. The guy that got hurt in four plays in 17 seconds, they rested him all preseason, right? You don't know when it's going to happen. And, you know, I just think that it's hard to really be ready for timing things and working out stuff with your offensive lineman, all this stuff, if you don't have a lot of preseason preparation as far as game time goes. So that moving into this game, I thought that the Bills, you know, when I saw this matchup, I was highly concerned about this Jets defense. I think the Jets defense is as good as any defense in the league right now. And it's not just scheme-wise, it's personnel-wise. They have some of the top players in the entire NFL on that defense. You look at Quinnen Williams, you look at C.J. Mosley, you look at Sauce Gardner. I mean, the list goes on and on. And I thought that as aggressive and as good as that defense is, they were a little nerved up about Stephon Diggs. They didn't quite know what was going to happen with Dalton Kincaid. And they played almost like a deliberately softer secondary. You know, they were giving up the short routes, right, guys? I mean, at one point, Josh Allen had, what, eight of nine for, like, 60 yards or whatever. They're giving up those shorter routes. Every now and then, Josh would hit an intermediate route. But it seemed to me that they were almost – their game plan was don't give up the home run to Stephon or Gabe or anybody else. We're going to make him be patient because history has shown that 17 can't be patient. And you know what? It happened.
He proved it. Yeah. He proved it.
The Jets had 16 or less, and instead of staying, Josh Allen hit, and he busted. And he busted in a big way. He busted with four turnovers, three interceptions, one fumble. And, you know, next thing you know, Aaron Rodgers is out. You think you have an advantage, and the Bills end up losing this football game. So, incredibly disheartening in that deal because it was something that was discussed all offseason, and it was a point of emphasis. And Josh talked about it all the time, protecting the football, being careful, being patient. And he went right back to, we call it hero ball. And it ended up costing the ball.
Yeah. I mean, sugar high Josh. I mean, like we can't get away from it. Like, and I don't mind that he plays hero ball, but in certain situations, like the first interception, he had open field in front of him. I think Jim Kelly could have picked up that first down.
Right.
As slow as he was, you know, but.
Right. He'd have made about 16 pump fakes before he ran, but right. he'd have got it.
And, you know, it comes down to it. And I don't know if you see this, but it's almost like, because you heard all off season that they're trying to keep him in the pocket so much or anything like that. I mean, it's right. almost like he looked, I don't want to say confused, but it's almost like, because last year he would have taken off and gotten that first down. But right. it's almost like they're trying to tell him to play smart and not take the hit, where that one he could have picked up 10 yards and gotten hit by a cornerback or gotten out of bounds, you know, and it's almost like he's processing, you know, these things all at one time. And, you know, unfortunately, you know, Cover One put out a stat the other day on Twitter that it was 42.9% pressure rate that they had on the Bills from the Jets defense, and Josh created 26.3 of those pressures himself.
Right.
So basically one out of every four pressure, he's creating that or putting himself into those pressures rather than, you know, sitting in the pocket in a clean right. pocket and, you know, basically just getting too much happy feet. So,
well, there's the thing about Josh. Yeah. The thing about Josh is he hates, and Troy Aikman made a point to talk about it in the broadcast. He looks down, he hates any sort of pressure up the middle. And mm-hmm. his escapability, his escape routes, if you watch him, it's all bailing out outside. So that's where that bringing 29-some percent of it into the equation, he created his own pressure because of where he escapes. He very rarely is he up, I believe, up into the pocket. Any mm-hmm. sort of inside pressure weirds him out for some reason. And, you know, the Jets had a little bit of that. But, you know, the thing about Josh is, and I think I agree with you, you made a good point. And I don't know if he's trying to please people or not with trying to throw the ball and not scramble for first downs or whatever. Josh has never been a quarterback that scrambles to throw. He scrambles to run. Mm-hmm. If you watch Shedeur Sanders at Colorado, that's what it's so impressive to me as a young quarterback. He will scramble to throw. His eyes are always downfield. Josh scrambles to get out of there. And if he's trying to change the way he plays in that aspect, that's not good because that's not who he is, obviously. I say it all the time. I think he's the best running back on their team. But he does have to be smart in getting down, and he does have to be smart with protecting the football. And those are two things he did not do on Monday night.
Well, and that's the other thing, though, with Josh, too, is you know, we all see the hero ball being played. We all see the, you know, I'm going to put this team on my back and do whatever I can. But it also comes down to there was multiple times that your best wide receiver is wide open. And you brought it up yourself and said he's trying to please other. It's almost like he's trying to please other people. And that's not just in, you know, playing smart. That's also on the field. Why is he not throwing it to Stephon Diggs as much as possible if he's open? Like, yes, he only had 1.9 yards of separation, but that's enough where Josh has proven that he is able to thread that in there and get that to him. And it just feels like any time that you put the ball anywhere within Stephon Diggs' reach, he's going to catch the ball.
Right.
So it's almost like, why are we throwing it to Gabe Davis on that one, you know, that one interception? Gabe did run a bad route, but Josh is trusting his arm, trusting, you know, what he sees and things like that. But he had three guys underneath. He had Latavius Murray for a dump off. He had Stephon Diggs over the middle, and he had Dalton Kincaid at the sticks. Who's either going to pick that up, or if he's a half a yard short, you either go for it with your 6'5", 240-pound quarterback up the middle, you know, sneak the ball, or you punt it, and instead of them having it on the 45, 50, they have it at the 10. So at that point, it's almost like you want Josh to take a step back and just kind of see what he can – like, it's try and get the ball into your best players is basically what I'm trying to get at. So,
well, the thing is you got to throw the ball to who's open. Okay. Right. And I know 1.9 yards, and we talk about Diggs all the time, and Diggs had his catches. Josh threw the ball to Diggs. He had 10 receptions. My issue with Monday night is that why, when you were making first downs, and yes, you weren't getting touchdowns in four plays, you were having to go 10 plays because of the way they were playing defense. With that defense you're playing against and their ability to turn the ball over and them giving you the short stuff, why all of a sudden did you feel that that wasn't enough? Why did I all of a sudden have to decide to try to throw, you know, post routes and throw picks and all those things? The Gabe Davis interception, yes, it wasn't a good route. He needed to go ahead and run straight at the receiver to try to freeze his feet, get his hips to raise up so he could get out of the break. But that's not why the pick was thrown. It wasn't Gabe's fault that the pick was thrown. The pick was thrown because quarterback, he threw the ball. He shouldn't have thrown the ball. I thought actually Gabe played a good game. I thought a couple of catches he had were really good. But I thought, you know, because right away, and this is an interesting concept, guys. Pat, Matt, this is an interesting concept. And I liken this to Russell Westbrook. And Westbrook was when he played at Oklahoma City, when he first got here, when the Oklahoma City stole the franchise from Seattle and they brought the Supersonics down here. There was a sense of no, those guys could do no wrong. Russell Westbrook could do no wrong. And then at some point in time, fans, when KD finally left, Harden was already gone, Russ was the man. There was a moment that all of a sudden people got really sick of Russ going like 3 for 35 from the 3-point line. And there was all of a sudden a fan accountability. Josh has not had this since he's been in Buffalo. This to me is an anomaly. This is the first week and since he's been in Buffalo, I believe, that he's had to take quite a bit of criticism from the fan base because, you know, Josh, let's face facts, guys. He was the most intercepted quarterback, most turned over quarterback in the league last year. He's got 84 or more turnovers already in his career, the most of anybody in this first, 5 years of their career. So this is a problem he's had, obviously, but he hasn't had that kind of accountability yet from the fan base and others. Now he's gotten it, and it'll be interesting to see what he does with it because for the longest time, you know, Stephon Diggs has always been the villain in this whole thing. He's always been the antagonist, and now all of a sudden the tables have turned a little bit, and it is interesting. So, but I also believe that Dorsey got way too much criticism. I thought Dorsey's game plan was great. I mean, he was calling great plays. They were dinking and dunking. even if the runs were what, 3 yards or 4 yards, they're still keeping them honest. So I thought Dorsey did a good job also.
See, and that's the only problem that I had with Dorsey's game is that second 15, but I understood it, you know, in overtime. Right. I understood you're right, because James Cook on the, you know, basically two quarters earlier picked up 13 yards on that same play.
Right.
They ran it to the other side where Quinn and Williams isn't, but, you know, I mean, that guy's just a terror. I mean, like, I don't know what's going on with him, but he is just a terror, man. He, you know, he's
well,
the
we
next.
Used to have an old saying. We used to have an old saying when I played, fellas, and the saying was this: those guys get paid too.
Yeah.
Which means they're pretty good. So
oh, absolutely.
Sometimes things will work, but sometimes they make a play on you. But you got to be able to rebound and get it the next snap.
Well, I know Pat has a couple questions for you specifically in your area of expertise. So okay. I'll let him go.
Well, Jerry, first of all, thank you for coming on.
No problem.
And second, my first question is, how do you feel our offensive line played on Monday?
Well, if you look at PFF grades, and I do have a subscription to PFF, they didn't play terribly well. The one player that did have a good grade, or I thought played pretty well, was Osiris Torrance. But I will say this was a team that, again, you're playing against the elite of the elite, right? So I didn't expect them to go out there and look like, you know, just a team that was going to just do whatever they wanted, because the Jets were a good team. I thought we struggled a little bit. I thought Spencer Brown struggled again. My biggest thing on Spencer is he seems to struggle with his punch and keeping guys off of him, which in turn causes him to get pushed back into the quarterback. I thought, like I said, Osiris, so they played fine. I thought he battled his rear end off, and I thought he showed some toughness and he showed some competitive spirit, which is good. Mitch Morris is as steady as they come, but if you watch the telecast, something happened to his hand, and he was kind of squeezing his hand. Mm-hmm. And if you notice, some of the collapses in the middle were because he had no right hand to punch, and you could see that arm just kind of collapse. So mm-hmm. he was dealing with something in the middle of the game. But again, I mean, Morris is a consummate pro, tremendous player, tremendous career. McGovern, I didn't even really notice him. So a lot of times in offensive line play, that's good. His PFF grade was okay. I don't think that's a game that he excels in. I don't think he's a guy that moves dudes from point A to point B. I think he's much more of a run in space and create running lanes because of movement. He's a good athlete. And then again, I thought Deion Dawkins disappointed. Mm-hmm. I don't think he played very well. I think his run blocking was, I think his PFF grade in run blocking was about 41% or something like that. You know, I thought Deion has slipped a little bit. Why that is, I don't know. I have my ideas. I have my feelings about it, but he's got to play better. And I really believe that he's kind of the catalyst of if this group is going to become solid and be able to win, you know, win games and contend for championships. I really believe that he's got to be the guy that gets it rolling. And, right now, he kind of picked up where he left off last season, which wasn't all that great. And hopefully he's able to do that. I know he's got the talent to do it. I know he's a talented player. But overall, I think that group was, for what they played against, about as good as could be expected.
Well, so a couple things. Yeah, go ahead, Pat. I'm sorry.
No, go ahead. No, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, I mean, you brought it up. I mean, in your opinion, without getting too much into it, what do you feel like is going on with Deion Dawkins?
I think I think he needs to work on his maybe he's got to work on some technique stuff. He's got to work on the shape a little bit. I think he might have got a little heavy. But again, my problem is this, and this is what's so hard about doing this, because I played, so mm-hmm. I'm sensitive to the fact that I'm not in their workout room. Mm-hmm. I'm not next to the scale. So I don't know what he would, you know, I'm not there. So I'm in Tulsa, Oklahoma. I'm, you know,
right.
18 hours away in a car. So it's hard for me to comment. I just watch what I see on TV and watch some of the things that maybe some people are having some issues with and speculate why. And here's a big thing. And it happened with me as well in my career. As I got older, and as you get older, it's harder to keep weight off. But as you get older and you gain weight, then you have deficiencies in movement and things like that. I went through the same thing. And it's hard as you move it towards your, you know, the end of your career, especially when you're a big guy. Morse is a dude that'll end up stopping playing. He'll probably be 235 and look just abbed up and be at the beach and look wonderful, right? You know, Spencer Brown, I think, is a guy that probably is going to lose a ton of weight. McGovern, the same thing. Deion is a naturally big dude. Mm-hmm. So you just have to watch as you get older, you know, things like that. But again, like I said, I don't know what the strength coaches have told him. I don't know what he's supposed to be. I just know he's a Pro Bowl player, and he's a Pro Bowl caliber player. He's been in the Pro Bowl. He's played tremendous football for the Bills. And I'm just looking at things and how do we get back to where we were. But it's also a natural, you know, maturation process. He is getting older in his career, and it gets a little bit harder as you get older.
So let's flip to the other side before, and this is, unless Pat has anything else, we'll move on and put this game in the rearview mirror. But as far as Spencer Brown goes, how can they help him fix that in your expertise of that of the offensive line?
My worry about Spencer is it's physical. My worry about Spencer is that he's the back issue is real, and I don't know if the back issue ever goes away. So you get varied, you know, where is his back? Where's the pain level and all those things? If you can't bend in this league, it's really, really hard. And when he has issues, you know, it's funny. You'll see him and he looks quick. He looks agile. Then the next game he's kind of lumbering a little bit. He's kind of, you know, strained a little bit. And I think that back thing is real with him. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure that's what the Bills fight all the time. Trying to keep him healthy, trying to keep him pain-free, trying to keep him moving.
Did you have anything else before we move on, Pat?
Oh, no, we're going to move on to week 2.
All right. So, yeah, like I said, I want to put this game in the rearview mirror. We have not as big of a test coming up here with the Raiders. It, you know, like we've always, like you said before, the other guys get paid too, but definitely not as high of a talent on defense. They do have, you know, Davante Adams. They do have, you know, Josh Jacobs and things like that on offense. But the defensive side, I could see, you know, I really want to see how Josh does, how the offensive line steps or, you know, comes back this game. How are you feeling going into the Raiders game?
I think the Bills have a really good opportunity to springboard off of a loss. Okay. The Raiders, while they do have some very good individual talent, one of my favorite players in the league, Tulsa's own Josh Jacobs. Just from up the street from where I live. Josh is a dynamic running back. I think he's probably still – we talked about it earlier, right? No preseason, hard to have timing when you first start. He missed a whole bunch of the preseason. So he's probably going to be a middle of the year, later, early part of the year before he really gets going. But, you know, I also look at probably the key matchup on offense for us besides, you know, we always want to know who's playing cornerback and who's playing against Diggs. You know, you got Max Crosby, who I think mm-hmm. is one of the most underrated defensive linemen in the league. I think he's an unbelievable player. He's aggressive. He's long, powerful, has a great bull rush. So Deion, and I'm not quite sure, I haven't watched enough film if they flip-flop, but whoever he's rushing against, which is usually – I believe the left side of our offensive line. So it would be Deion. That's going to be a big matchup. Those mm-hmm. tackles are going to have to get after him. And, you know, Deion's going to have a big game to keep him off of Josh because he is a dynamic player. And I think he sets the tone on their defense. So that's one thing I'm looking at, but I do believe this is a matchup that the Bills can get healthy in real quick. I think stat wise guys, they're in the lower half. They're in the lower half, if not the bottom offensively. I think they get through for 200 in the first game. Rushing, I think they had about 60-some yards. Defensively, they're middle of the pack, kind of middle of the league, middle bottom. So first week-wise, they did not have a ton of success. But, you know, it's always hard to figure that out after one game, but that's where they sit after one game. And, again, I think if mentally 17's in it, we should be fine.
Do you think that they try and use Crosby's aggressiveness against him in this game with Josh to maybe get him out on the outside a little bit more, not necessarily running the ball, but maybe
right.
like getting him out and moving that pocket for him?
They could, but the problem is that Crosby is incredibly good in space. Mm-hmm. He's athletic, he's long, and creates issues in that area as well. So, you know, yeah, they could try to, but I don't think that that's something that the Bills necessarily do very much of, as far as a ton of, you know, they do have a little bit of screen game and stuff like that, but you don't see a ton of reverses or fly sweeps or much misdirection out of them. They, their offense right now, and especially what they did the other night on Monday Night Football, was almost kind of West Coast-ish. Mm-hmm. A lot of dinking to dunking and things like that. So, but yeah, I don't think they're a very big misdirection team.
Yeah, and for sure, I definitely don't think they're a big misdirection thing. I was just maybe thinking if they can get Josh necessarily out of the pocket and do some roles
right.
that they used
well,
to
Well, what
do
they can that. Do is they can bring in Gilliam, they can bring in a back and secure that mm-hmm. side with the back to help Deion out if he needs it. I don't think Josh, you know, I keep going back to what you guys talked about earlier, and I never thought of it, but and I don't know why I didn't think about it earlier, but you know, the aspect of, like you said, 15, 20 yards of clear real estate, he doesn't run it. When has he ever not done that?
Right.
So hopefully, you know, I was at the Miami game last year in Buffalo with my sons, and, you know, that game was kind of grinding along and just kind of ugly. And second half, he took the game over with his legs, right? I mean, yeah. Had a huge run and started taking it over. And that to me is when I think he's really good. So if we're going to think about it this way, guys, if we're going to preach patience to Josh Allen, let's not preach patience in his running ability and how he, and when he decides to run it, let's just preach it on the fact where we don't need to throw post routes into double and triple coverage 40 yards downfield, you know, preach the patience in the passing game. But to me with him, if it's there, go. And, you know, maybe once in a blue moon slide and not take a direct hit from three guys at one time. That would be nice as well.
Go ahead, Pat. I know you had a question.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No, that would be nice. I want to see him run a little bit more.
Right.
But my question is for you. How do you feel Vegas' O-line is going to hold up against our defensive line, which looked really good on Monday?
It'll give him some fits. But I also think Josh McDaniels is a really good coach. And, you know, Jimmy G, for as much – as he gets, you know, he's a quarterback that's good. I think that our defensive line is really, really good in gap scheme football, which when I mean gap scheme football, I mean when you're running power and counter and all those types of things, right? Because they're fast. They're not terribly big. Now we got Jordan Phillips hurt again. I mean, that took, a quarter and a half, and he's already back being hurt.
I don't want to interrupt you, but he was not.
Oh, he wasn't? Okay, no, good. Yeah, no, that's
was the only one, and okay, he was good. Full participant.
Okay, good. That's good to know because when he went out in the game the other day, I don't think he came back in. And with him being back, that's good because he's a huge part of this. Because my biggest complaint about our defensive front, we are fast, but we're not very big. And I can't have Ed Oliver trying to play one technique. I need Jordan Phillips. I need big guys, right?
Yeah.
I need the bigger, the better, because that's where I thought we were weak last season, up the middle on both sides of the ball. We fixed that somewhat on offense. We need the Jordan Phillipses and those guys to, you know, the Tim Settles and those guys to play well. I think they'll have a good day. I thought the star of the show on defense Monday night was Greg Rousseau. And everybody's like, well, he had one tackle or he had no tackles. Look at what he did to disrupt the run game. Look at what he did with pressures. You know, tackles it's not always a good indicator of good play. Right. If you really look at defenses, a lot of defense coordinators will tell you, I want my linebackers and my box safety or whatever to be the guys that make the plays or make the tackles. If the D linemen get a few, that's fine. But I want them disrupting things, slowing stuff down. Right. And I thought he played a wonderful football game. And hopefully he has another week like that this week because, you know, he's, you know, him. And then you got Floyd as well. Floyd pressured the quarterback really good. Great signing to take the pressure off until Vaughn comes back after 4 weeks. So, yeah, I thought our D-line played pretty good. I thought they played well.
What did you think of Terrell Bernard?
He led the team in tackles, but I also think at times he looked a little bit lost. He's been out for the preseason. He didn't get much time, so it's going to take him a bit to get used to it. I think that what we were used to in Edmonds is much more of a see ball, get ball kind of linebacker. He's a long guy. He's a run stuff down, right? He's not a guy that's going to stick his face in A gap or B gap and take leads on. He's a Tampa 2, drop and cover, play the flats, drag guys down type of linebacker. And in McDermott's defenses, where everywhere he's been, he's always had that kind of tackle-to-tackle plugger linebacker. I don't know if Bernard can be that. I think Bernard can play and be a guy that maybe takes the pressure off until we are able to get a guy to replace him or get a guy that fits that scheme. But I'm not going to go ahead and say, hey, he's horrible. I want to see some games. Give me six games. Mm-hmm. Give me eight games, because he did not play very much in the preseason due to injury. But he did lead the league in tackles, or lead the team in tackles on Monday night. Sarah told me the other night he was responsible for a misalignment that caused that big run. I don't know. I didn't hear that. But, it'll take a little bit to get used to it. But I think he was okay. I think he was fine.
Yeah, I mean, as far as the misalignment goes, I mean, it was more on Trey White, I would think, just from watching the All-22. Right. Because Trey White was there and he missed the tackle. The Bills themselves had seven missed tackles in that game.
And I real quick on that, you know, guys, you're going to see that a little bit more. So if you remember Leslie Frazier, what? He ran two high safeties and he played everything in front of him, right? Right. McDermott's a little different, plays some cover three, likes to come downhill, take some chances. So if guys do get past the first level, you will give some big plays up because of that.
Oh, absolutely. And, I really am excited for this defense because of how well they played. You take out Breece Hall's two runs for 109 yards. I think they had 30-something yards, rushing. And then on top of that, you had all the short fields that you gave them because of, the fumble and then the Josh interception on the 48, 50-ish yard line. So that really kind of propelled them into that victory, into the end. How do you feel the game is going to go? Like, what do you feel like? Obviously we talked about it. You think that they're going to, bounce back and have a really good game. What do you feel the score is going to be?
I hate giving predictions. I really do. I'll tell you, I think the Bills are going to win. I think they're going to win by two scores at least. To give you an exact, I think the other night on our show, I said, 31-24 or it was 34-21. So I guess it's maybe not quite two scores, but it's enough. I think that's what I said. I still want to see a little bit. I think this team, guys, and I got to go here in a second. If you can believe this, I'm going to go watch a hockey game here when I leave here in Oklahoma. Nothing wrong with that. I'm going to watch a little college hockey. I got some kids my son played with are still playing in college. But when I look at this team, it's a tremendously hard schedule, and it's you've got some new things going on. So there's going to be some attrition. There's going to be some setbacks. The goal this season is to make the playoffs. That's it is every year, right? But we want to, everybody's talking about, 13-4, 14-3, win the AFC East. I think right now we need to figure out who we are. We need to work through some of these pains we had on Monday night. We got to make sure our defense is coming around with McDermott calling plays. And see, get through this attrition, win as many as we can, and then see where we are. I think the biggest goal right now is let's get in the playoffs. However it happens, I don't care. Just get in the playoffs. Because the AFC East teams this year, every one of them has the top four. You take those four teams, they all have the top four hardest schedules in the NFL. So, tremendously tough football ahead. The Raiders are nobody to laugh at or scoff or whatever. They're going to come and they're going to be prepared and they're going to play. Mm-hmm. But I still think we got way too much firepower. I think we match up well against them, and I think we'll be fine.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I personally, I think if we get through, you know, the Dolphins and they stack these next two wins against the Raiders and the Commanders going into Miami,
right.
I think when you hit the Bengals, you're either 7-2, 8-1.
Right.
You know, right around there. So, I mean, that's basically all they got to do is each quarter, you know, 3-1 in each quarter,
right.
You know, and just start, keep stacking wins and you're going to be in the playoffs. So with that being said, I know Jerry, you wanted to get going. So we definitely want to thank you for being on.
You got something, Pat?
No, I was just going to say thank you.
All right, man. All right.
Definitely thank you for being on, Jerry. And hopefully we can do it again soon.
Hey guys,
and,
I had a good time. This time works well. So if you guys want to, whenever you want to hit me up. I'm always available. I enjoy doing this stuff. It gives me the opportunity to probably the one good thing or one cool thing that came out of COVID, right?
Yeah, right.
We got technology like this, and we get to meet people from all over the place. And the more people I meet from the city of Buffalo and the area of Buffalo, the better. So thanks again. Nice to meet you guys. I appreciate having me on, and let's do it again sometime.
Absolutely, Jerry. Have a wonderful rest of your night.
All right, guys. See you later. Bye-bye.
All right, and that Jerry was brought to you by Sons of Erie. You know, definitely check them out for some art, www.sonsoferie.com. The link is actually in our YouTube description, so definitely check that out. Thank you again for Jerry coming on, and definitely, Pat, thank you for setting that up. So it was a lot of fun with him. And, yeah, so how are your feelings? As far as the Jets game, I know we said we want to put that in the rearview mirror, but you didn't really speak up at all when we were talking about that. So I'm going to give you some time here to kind of go over what your feelings were.
Okay. Well, it was really frustrating. I think Josh took 26 checkdowns in the game is what I heard from a mutual friend of ours. I just felt like it looked like he looked lost, like in his eyes. He just didn't was like shell-shocked. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I haven't seen that look in him in quite some time. Probably since his rookie year. I mean, I felt like Diggs played well. I didn't like that last route, Gabe Davis, for the third interception. I thought it was a little bit of a sloppy route.
It was very, very sloppy route. He needed to, like Jerry said, he needed to freeze the defender and get, you know, make a better cut on that and get on the outside. And that same mutual friend, and, you know, I'm sure we can say his name, Kevin Masseri, so from Cover One. He was the one that said that the 26 checkdowns. But he was also saying the other night on Twitter Spaces is you know, he needed to make a better cut on that. He didn't get out there, and he, you know, somebody who's really good at that is somebody like Dawson Knox. I don't know why they specifically had him running that, didn't have him running that route instead. But also too, it was almost like the Jets baited him in, Josh into that throw too, because they basically let him open, and Whitehead made a heck of a play on that, on the ball to, you know, get in front of him and everything like that. And, you know, so I would have rather seen him take the 3 yards with Diggs, the check down out of the backfield with Murray on the left side there, or, you know, try and fit it into Kincaid there, because Sauce Gardner was not on him, you know, or wouldn't have been on him. If he doesn't pick up that first down, like I said earlier in the show, you have a fourth and one, and you're going to take your 6'5" quarterback and let him go up the middle, whether you do the Philly, you know, I don't want to call it a Philly special because we know what the Philly special is, but that's their Philly special type of run where they stack behind the quarterback and push them forward. So with that being said, I would have rather seen him take a step back, kind of calm his mind down a little bit. And the one thing I will say about that is after that, seeing Stephon Diggs go on the sideline and prop him up and basically get him going again, you know, that I think that really helped him come down at the end of the game to kick that field goal and put us into a position to get into overtime. So go ahead.
No, go ahead.
No, I was just going to move on to the Raiders game, but if you have any other last thoughts on the Jets.
Yeah. I do want to say once again, our defensive line played well. Extremely well.
Yeah.
I think Ed Oliver led our team in pressures, I believe. Yeah, but so, does he
I know you had some PFF grades too for you know, the top five on defense and offense. So let's do our defense top five first.
Defensive PFF grades. was Greg Rousseau at 86.2, which is 10th in the league. Micah Hyde was at 85.6, which was 5th in the league. Then you had Matt Milano, who had the pick, had a 77.0 grade, which was 15th. Ed Oliver had a 63.2, which was 62nd, which I felt he had a little bit of a better game than a 63.2. That Daquan Jones with a 62.7, which was 65th.
Yeah, that's definitely not bad. I mean, that definitely shows our defensive line was, you know, really picking it up. And then, you know, as far as Greg Rousseau on run plays was uncontrollable. Like, they could not, you know, get to or stop him with their offensive line. He was awesome on pass rush. He was, and then Leonard Floyd himself, he was in the backfield almost every time he was on the field. It was almost like you should have put, it's almost like you should have put a Jets jersey on.
Right.
You know, as much as he was in the backfield. So I'm not worried so much about that game. We all know week one is a liar. We all do. I mean, you saw what the Bills did. What was it? 2021 against the Steelers.
Yeah.
When they came out and they lost that game. Yes. They lost in 13 seconds in the Chiefs, but had, you know, that was a game where we ended up in the divisional round after losing the first game. So yeah.
The perfect postseason by Josh Allen too.
Yeah. And I mean, it really, week one is a big liar, because especially more now, even like Jerry was saying at the beginning of our show, is preseason, as much as everybody hates preseason. Oh, it doesn't matter. Doesn't count. Doesn't. They don't do two-a-days anymore they don't have a big OTA. They don't have big mini camps anymore. They don't have, and they're not very, I can't think of the word. Exactly. Yeah. Anyways, yeah. They're not going so high pressure in them, so they're not getting the, for lack of a better term, they're not getting the benefit out of it. It's basically just walkthroughs and workouts. You know, so unfortunately, there's not a lot of things there anymore that these guys can go out and do to be together. I mean, yeah, they could get together in the off season, things like that, but like Jerry was saying earlier, that like, four plays for Aaron Rodgers. He had one drive in the preseason. That doesn't get somebody ready for full out football. So it comes down to it. Whereas is that one of the reasons that he got hurt? Does he get hurt if he plays all the preseason games? We don't know. But did he get hurt because of the turf? We don't know. But as far as that stuff goes, you would have liked to see maybe Josh play a little bit more in preseason, maybe get like a series in the first game, play like a half in the second game, or maybe three quarters in the second game. And then, you know, at least go out for a quarter in the third game, just to kind of, cause you got to get these guys in rhythm. And it's not just Josh. Look at how bad the Bears were. Like, you know,
yeah.
I mean, Tremaine Edmonds had a horrible game. Justin Fields had a horrible game. Look at the Giants.
They got blown out by 40. 40-0
they lost. Now, if they come back and kill somebody, you know, 31-15 or 31-14, we'll know. Week one is a liar. Like, that's a big thing. Yeah. Yeah. 82 yards.
82 passing yards.
Yeah. 82 yards. They lose to the Cleveland Browns, what, 21-3, 24-3? Something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's, like, I watched that game. Yes, it was a monsoon for most of the game out there, but Joe Burrow was still putting the ball in the air. He just was not hitting his targets. He was not hitting, you know. So let's put week one behind us. We are 0-1. The Bills are 0-1, but let's continue moving forward. How are you feeling about this Raiders game?
Well, kind of like what Jerry said earlier, they're not really something to laugh at. They do have good players. They do. I feel confident. I feel like their defense can be dealt with. I don't think there's a corner that can stick with Stephon Diggs, if we're being honest. Mm-hmm. Look what he just did to Sauce Gardner.
Right.
I feel like we will see a better game from Gabe Davis. We'll see more targets. I feel like we will get Kincaid more involved to win 4 for 4, 4 targets, four receptions. And I think we'll see a little bit of a better game from James Cook, who our friend Kevin, I believe he, I don't want to put the words in his mouth, but I believe he said something like he wasn't making nobody miss.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like we'll see more better runs from James Cook. That's right. And I feel like our defensive line will be in the backfield once again, quite a bit.
Yeah.
Jimmy Garoppolo has a bummed ankle right now. We got to take advantage of that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, our defense has to take advantage of the fact that, you know, Devontae Adams, I know, was on the injury report. Jacoby Myers probably isn't going to play this game because of a concussion unless he clears. You're going to have, you know, their offensive line going against our defensive line, who is, you know, who still has Ed Oliver, still has Daquan Jones. Jordan Phillips is healthy. Or as healthy as he can be. He did not show up on the injury report. So, then Puna Ford. Yeah. I mean, Leonard Floyd, Greg Rousseau, those guys are going to be coming off the edge and getting to Jimmy Garoppolo. So and Jimmy Garoppolo isn't the type of mover that even Zach Wilson is, or even Aaron Rodgers is.
Right.
So he's probably going to be in the pocket a lot, and they're going to have their chances to put pressure on them up the middle and from the outside, and kind of, you know, hopefully trade off sacks with each other, pushing them back into each other. So I want to see from this game, I want to see Terrell Bernard improve on his last game. Yes, he led the team in tackles, but I do want to see him, you know, maybe shooting gaps better. I want to see him playing, more. I want to see him in coverage better, because I know he had that one. I can't remember whether it was a pass interference or a hold. I think it was a hold on one of the calls that kept their drive alive. I think it was their first or second drive, but you didn't really see many penalties or many bad plays from him. But you didn't see it, anything that really stuck out either. So
it's like one of those games where it's like, you didn't see him, but he didn't do nothing bad to be seen. It was kind of like a neutral ground.
And I know that with Taylor Rapp, they were running some big nickel with him in there. I would rather see somebody like Dorian Williams getting a chance to hop in there and play rather than Taylor Rapp in those run situations. But he didn't do bad either. Like, I can't sit here and say that he, you know, did real bad. So, because again, what did they finish with? 150 yards or something like that.
Yeah.
And Breece Hall had 100 and I think 24 of those.
Oh yeah.
So you take that out of there. You take even take the two big runs out of there. You're talking only like 40 yards for him.
And we held Dalvin Cook to, I think, 13 attempts for 33 yards.
Yeah, I mean, it's a good running back. It's, yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, look what he did to us last year with Minnesota.
Yeah, 80 yard touchdown.
So I want to see a lot of those things, you know, start to progress this week. I want to see Josh not be sugar high Josh. I really want to see that, because I want to see him making good decisions. I don't care if he checks the ball down or not, or you know, finds the guys 15 yards deep. But don't, when you have clear open space in front of you, go be Josh Allen.
Yeah, that's what makes.
I'm not saying go hurdle somebody. I'm not saying go hurdle somebody. Again, he tried to do it on a third and 13 or whatever it was, and 7 yards short, he's hurdling somebody that he's not going anywhere. Should have just gotten down out of bounds or slid or anything like that. But if you have open space, go be Josh Allen. Go pick up a first down, get out of bounds, slide, whatever you got to do. But don't take that part of that out of the game, because that's one of the things that makes Josh Allen great.
Exactly.
So
what makes sense.
At this point right now, I want to see that from them. I want to see them give Stephon Diggs more targets, because he only – literally before that last drive, he had 2 targets.
Yeah. It was all in the first half, it felt like.
Correct. It was. He had 2 targets in the second half before that last drive.
We always do that with him.
You know, and I'm not even going to talk about the things that happened in overtime, because they shouldn't have, against that team, they shouldn't have even been in there. But I want to see the punt team cover kicks better against the Raiders. And so there's a lot that needs to, I don't want to say a lot. There's a few things that need to be improved on, but if Josh Allen plays a better game, they're going to win this game by at least two scores.
I agree. I think when you say there's stuff that has to be worked on, it starts with the quarterback. Mm-hmm. Obviously, four turnovers. Sometimes you put the defense in a hard spot, like the fumble. I believe they're already in the red zone with that fumble.
Either in it or just out of it, yeah.
Yeah. And to your point about the turnovers, I do have a fun fact here for you. Mm-hmm. This was on Built in Buffalo's Twitter page. In games immediately after Josh Allen commits 3+ turnovers, he averages 255 passing yards with 8 passing touchdowns and 2 combined turnovers. He's 5-0 in those games. The average margin of victory is 14.8.
Yeah, I mean, so it's almost like I really want to see, like, you know, angry Josh come out and just go out and just run up the score. Like, at this point, who cares? Just go out and play your game. Find Stephon Diggs, find Gabriel Davis, find Dalton Kincaid, get Kincaid involved way more in this offense than he was last week. Because what was it? 3 targets, 3 catches?
4 targets, 4 catches. Yeah. 26 yards. And yeah, one of those was a rack for like 20 yards.
Yeah. Like yeah. Yards. I mean, it's like get the ball in your first rounder's hands, get the ball in Stephon Diggs' hands, use a little bit more, maybe screen game ish, not necessarily like every play, but that's how you slow down somebody like Max Crosby, is get the screen game going, get the run game going. But again, Deion Dawkins has to be better. Spencer Brown has to be better. I'd like to see some more like chip blocking on the edges and helping out Deion or Spencer Brown, depending on which side it was. There was a couple different plays where I feel like, you know, and I could be wrong, but watching the tape, it's almost like there should have been a chip block there to help on certain plays. One time from Dawson Knox that I saw, one time from James Cook that I saw. But at that point, it doesn't matter. Like, the game's over with, but I want to see more improvement. I want to see them improve each and every single week. So we got the Raiders coming up this week, we got the Commanders, and then we got the Dolphins. And then we got Jacksonville and London, and then we got the Giants. So like I was saying before, if you can get into that Dolphins game at 2-1 and you come out of that at 3-1,
rack up some wins before the second half of the schedule, which gets rough.
It does. And it really, really does get rough there. And so what else you got for us tonight, Pat? I know you had a few other things.
I'm trying to look right here. Well, the first thing is, I asked Jerry this earlier. How do you feel about our defensive line going up against Oakland's offensive line?
I think you're going to see about more of the same that you saw last week, because the Raiders don't have as good of an offensive line, not saying the Jets have a great offensive line or anything like that, because they don't, but I would put them on like the same tier of offensive line. So I can see maybe a little bit more aggressiveness out of McDermott than he had against even the Jets, but I'm not the one calling the plays. If it was me, I would be putting pressure on him all the time as much as I possibly can, because Josh Jacobs is got to prove that he can run the ball. Only having no preseason, having no OTAs, having no mini camps, having nothing, and just starting practice like a couple weeks ago. So they've got to prove to me that they can run the ball. Otherwise, I'm just going to pin my ears back and go get Jimmy Garoppolo.
I agree with you.
So, with as far as that Oliver goes, I'm very happy to see him, you know, after he signed the contract, being in the backfield a lot against the Jets. I hope we see more of that this week with against the Raiders. I personally, again, I'm very much like Jerry. I don't like making, you know, predictions or anything like that, but I do see the Bills potentially putting up 40 points in this game.
I hope so. We need it, especially.
I can see this game being 40 to 17, 40 to 21, something like that. you know, because they still have Davante Adams on that side. They still have Josh Jacobs on that side. If Jacoby Myers plays, they have him. They still have Hunter Renfro, you know, on their team. So it really is going to come down to what they will be able to scheme up on defense and what they can scheme up on offense to, you know, stop Max Crosby. Because it's like any good player in the NFL. He's going to get his tackles. He's going to get his sacks. He's going to make his plays. But they can't be costly plays. They can't be strip sacks. They can't force interceptions. They can't. So that's another thing that Josh has to do, is be smart. And when he does, you know, go either scramble or whatever, and he's got to stop creating his own pressure.
Yeah.
He's got to stop putting himself into those situations where he is taking hits in the pocket caused by himself.
Yeah. Which makes the offensive line looks bad, and it's just not good.
Right.
Now, what is your biggest key to victory?
My biggest key to the game is Josh Allen. 100% Josh Allen. He needs to come out and show that he is Josh Allen. He needs to be the 5-0 Josh Allen after the 3+ interceptions. He needs to be angry Josh. And, you know, if he's not, there might be a little bit of a problem.
Yeah. Well.
So, how do you feel? What is your key to the game?
I'll give you two. My first one is Josh Allen. Protect the ball. I don't want to see a turnover in this game. I really don't. I know it's hard, especially with the type of quarterback he is, but I don't want to see a turnover. And for my defensive key to the game, it's going to be stop the run, make Jimmy Garoppolo throw the ball. Josh Jacobs is a really good running back.
Mm-hmm.
If they're going to beat us, I want Jimmy Garoppolo to try to beat us with his arm. That I don't trust.
Yeah, I don't either. I don't either. And I think that they can put a lot of pressure on him. I think that they can, you know, make him see, you know, for lack of better terms, I think that they can make him see ghosts, you know, make some bad, yeah, make some bad plays and you know, go from there. So I want to touch on that fumble or that turnover thing. I'm okay as long as they're not stupid turnovers for Josh.
Right.
Like if he's on, like as much as I hate going back to the Jets game, but if it's another one like that where it's third and whatever, he should have ran for it, but he decides to throw it down the field, gets intercepted, they're on the 4-yard line. Okay, it's like a punt. Cool. If that's the only thing that happens, fine. I'm okay with that. But you can't have red zone interceptions. You can't have you can't have a fumble where it puts them in the red zone. You can't, you know, make stupid errors, stupid mistakes like that. So as far as that goes, that's basically is my, you know, my other key to the game. I completely agree with you on that, is protecting the ball. And that's not just from Josh Allen. It's from any of the offensive players that we have. And defense, just keep doing what they do. It just keep pinning your ears back, going and get the quarterback. I do want to see the run game cleaned up as far as the big plays, because if they don't have those couple of big plays, who knows what happens? I mean, they take three there. If they don't get that three and the Bills stop them, who knows? Maybe they come down and score again. You know, there's a lot of things. There's a lot of what ifs that could have happened, but they need to continue to protect the ball. They need to continue to build on, you know, a little bit on the run game. And that's pretty much all I got. Like I said, I mean, how do you feel the game's going to go?
I feel like we will win. It will be a 2-possession win for us. I feel like we will see a cleaner Josh Allen. I think the defense is going to continue what it did last week. And I think we will see a bit more polished run game from James Cook. Maybe we see a tad bit more Damian Harris. We didn't see him a lot last week. And I think we'll see just like Josh trusting his playmakers outside of Stephon Diggs. I think we will see a little bit more Dalton Kincaid as well as they continue to build that chemistry.
And that's a big word that you just threw around there, is trust. And he has a lot of trust in Stephon Diggs. So I'd like to see that with a lot of other players as well. So it's not just the Steph and Josh show. But at the same time, Steph is on open almost every single play. Yes, it was only by a yard, 1.9 yards of separation, but Josh has thrown those balls to him, and he comes down with them 9 times out of 10. You know, I know it's not that good of a thing, but if you put it in his vicinity, he's most likely going to catch the ball. So with that being said, what is your prediction on the score?
I think Buffalo's going to win 34-24.
And I have it myself 40-17. So with that being said, Pat, definitely thank you again for joining me.
What if I can't one more host?
What's that?
I want to give a special thank you to Jenna and the Undercovers for creating the intro for us. It's awesome. I hope you guys like it. So thank you again, Jenna.
Yes, Jenna, thank you so much for creating that. And definitely check out the Undercovers cast on now Wednesdays at 7. Definitely check them out over there with Tommy, Jenna, Ben, and Paul. And definitely thank you for hopping on with us tonight. Definitely want to thank Jerry for hopping on with us tonight. And Pat, again, thank you for hopping on with me. And thanks again for getting Jerry to come on.
No problem.
Buffalo Basement Podcast has been brought to you by Sons of Erie. Definitely check them out, www.sonsoferie.com. Great pieces of art there. Definitely check them out. And the link should be in the description on YouTube. So if you want to check them out, definitely give them a shout out or give them a shot and see what their art looks like. Definitely some great pieces there. So from myself, Matt Dygert, Pat Bruckness, thank you again for joining us, and have a good night. We'll see you next Thursday.
See you next Thursday.